Well, good evening, church family, visitors. If you're visiting this evening, welcome. My name is Mirari Herrera, one of the interns here. I'd like to make one announcement, and it's for middle school tubing, which is happening February 24. Today is the last day to sign up, so please sign up at the Resource Center in the back. Well, what a glorious day to end this day with the worship of our Lord. Amen. It's a glorious day, not because it's Super Bowl Sunday and because the 49ers might put a whooping on the Chiefs, but because, as we heard this morning, worthy is the Lamb. And so please stand and hear this call to worship. The call to worship this evening comes from Psalm 32, verses 1 and 2, and verses 10 and 11. And it says, "Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. Many are the sorrows of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds the one who trusts in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord, and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart." Amen. So let's respond to that beautiful call to worship with Trinity Psalter 441, "Jesus Sinners Doth Receive."
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Oh Lord, what a wonderful truth it is that you receive sinners. We who had no claim on your grace, we who were not mighty or great or of privilege, Lord, you came down, you condescended in your Son Jesus to redeem us, to make us heirs, co-heirs with Christ, of riches beyond our wildest imagination. And Lord, help us to never think that we can earn all of your grace, but Lord, to freely, with empty hands, receive all that you have to give us in Christ as he is offered in the gospel. And so be with us tonight as we continue singing to you because you are worthy, and as you, through your word, speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing now Trinity Psalter Hymnal 496, My Jesus, I Love Thee. This evening, we'll continue in our consecutive reading of the Psalms, and we'll be in Psalm 89. And it's a long chapter, but it'd be great to situate us to understand the lament that this psalm is. In verse 38, the writer of the psalm says, "But now you have cast off and rejected." Scholars agree that this psalm was written when Judah was in captivity. And so the people of God have been decimated. Their cities have been decimated and taken into captivity. And so still the psalmist is able to praise the steadfast love of God. Now, what does that mean for us? Oftentimes, we're put in a false predicament, false dichotomy, in that since we're Christians, sometimes there's a belief that we should just grin and bear it despite how tough a trial is or how difficult a struggle is, or simply live in despair when we go through trials. But as we see in the psalm, the psalmist holds together the steadfast love and the covenant promises of the Lord while in exile. And so, let's read from verse 1. I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever. With my mouth I will make known your faithfulness to all generations. For I said, steadfast love will be built up forever. In the heavens you will establish your faithfulness. You have said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David my servant, I will establish your offspring forever and build your throne for all generations. Let the heavens praise your wonders, O Lord, your faithfulness in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies can be compared to the Lord? Who among the heavenly beings is like the Lord? A God greatly to be feared in the council of the holy ones, and awesome above all who are around him. O Lord God of hosts, who is mighty as you are, O Lord, with your faithfulness all around you. You rule the raging of the sea. When its waves rise, you still them. You crushed Rahab like a carcass. You scattered your enemies with your mighty arm. The heavens are yours. The earth also is yours. The world and all that is in it, you have founded them. The north and the south, you have created them. Tabor and Hermon joyously praise your name. You have a mighty arm. Strong is your hand. High your right hand. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Steadfast love and faithfulness go before you. Blessed are the people who know the festal shout, who walk, O Lord, in the light of your face, who exult in your name all the day, and in your righteousness are exalted. For you are the glory of their strength. By your favor, our horn is exalted. For our shield belongs to the Lord, our King to the Holy One of Israel. Of old you spoke in a vision to your godly one and said, I have granted help to one who is mighty. I have exalted one chosen from my people. I have found David my servant. My holy oil I have anointed him, so that my hand shall be established with him. My arm also shall strengthen him. The enemy shall not outwit him. The wicked shall not humble him. I will crush his foes before him and strike down those who hate him. My faithfulness and my steadfast love shall be with him, and in my name shall his horn be exalted. I will set his hand on the sea and his right hand on the rivers. He shall cry to me, you are my father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. And I will make him the firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth. My steadfast love I will keep for him forever, and my covenant will stand firm for him. I will establish his offspring forever and his throne as the days of the heavens. If his children forsake my law and do not walk according to my rules, if they violate my statutes and do not keep my commandments, then I will punish their transgression with the rod of their iniquity with stripes. But I will not remove from him my steadfast love or be false to my faithfulness. I will not violate my covenant or alter the word that went forth from my lips. Once for all, I have sworn by my holiness, I will not lie to David. His offspring shall endure forever, his throne as long as the sun before me. Like the moon, it shall be established forever, a faithful witness in the skies. But now you have cast off and rejected. You are full of wrath against your anointed. You have renounced the covenant with your servant. and you have defiled his crown in the dust. You have breached all his walls. You have laid his strongholds in ruins. All who pass by plunder him. He has become the scorn of his neighbors. You have exalted the right hand of his foes. You have made all his enemies rejoice. You have also turned back the edge of his sword. And you have not made him stand in battle. You have made his splendor to cease and cast his throne to the ground. You have cut short the days of his youth. You have covered him with shame. How long, O Lord, will you hide yourself forever? How long will your wrath burn like fire? Remember how short my time is. For what vanity you have created all the children of man. What man can live and never see death? Who can deliver his soul from the power of Sheol? Lord, where is your steadfast love of old, which by your faithfulness you swore to David? Remember, O Lord, how your servants are mocked, and how I bear in my heart the insults of all the many nations, with which your enemies mock, O Lord, with which they mock the footsteps of your anointed. Blessed be the Lord forever. Amen and amen. You can hear the cry of the psalmist, and he's claiming God's covenant promises. And the beauty is that in Christ, the offspring of David, he is the one who receives the wrath that is in verse 38. You are full of wrath, the psalmist says, against your anointed. And Christ, in his atonement, in his propitiation, took the wrath of God so that we, his redeemed, do not have to bear that. And that is good news for us. Amen? Let's now turn to prayer for missions and evangelism as we pray for Cedar OPC, Breakwater Church in Wisconsin, and our mission in Haiti. So let's turn to prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you that we are part of something bigger. That you, O Lord, whose throne sits on righteousness and justice, who has made this world your footstool, have established your kingdom upon it, and you, Lord, are building your church. And we thank you that we are part of a body that goes beyond the walls of this building and the boundaries of our cities, Lord, into the whole world. And so this evening we pray for Cedar OPC. We pray for Pastor Steve Igo, their session. I pray that you would encourage them in the gospel, that you would strengthen them as they lead that congregation. Lord, as they counsel, as they get to know your sheep, and as they lead them to the fountain of water, who is Jesus Christ. I pray for their missions conference that is coming March 1. I ask that you would bless that event, that it would encourage the people who attend, that they would be able to see how they are a part of a move of the gospel throughout the world. We pray for Breakwater Church in Sheboygan, Wisconsin. We pray for Nate Strom, the pastor. We thank you for the opportunity and privilege that you've given them to walk alongside unbelievers, those who are grappling with the gospel and with Christ. And Lord, we pray that you would give them the wisdom and the love and the compassion to walk along those who doubt. We thank you for the new members that have joined their church. Would you use these new members for the encouragement of the body? And that you would continue adding new members, that it would be a witness to the work that you are doing in the hearts of people. And we thank you for ongoing ministries that they have and the opportunity to schedule a retreat. We pray that would minister to those who will attend that retreat. We pray for our mission in Haiti, for Octavius and Marie Delphilt. Lord, the situation, the political and economic unrest in Haiti is dire. And we thank you that they've continued gathering for worship, that you have moved in the hearts of your saints to continue gathering to worship you and to participate in the gospel, in edifying one another. Lord, they're able to, in the flesh, be able to identify with what the psalmist talks about in Psalm 89. The violence, the political unrest, the threats, the lack of law enforcement. Lord, preserve them. Hold them close to your heart. Lord, we pray that you would continue providing the growth in you that they ask for. And we also want to add a word of thanksgiving to theirs for the fact that you continue building them and strengthening them. And help us to Lord, be those who can hold them in prayer. We pray for our church here in Zealand and in the surrounding communities. We pray that you would use us, Lord, to continue being a witness to your goodness and your holiness, to your kingship and your sovereign work in our lives and in the world. Lord, strengthen us, give us opportunities to share the gospel, and give us the wisdom in those moments where, when we do share the gospel, to exalt Jesus in all that we say and do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This evening, our God's tithes and our offerings will be for the general fund of the church.
Please pray with me. Father in heaven, we worship you tonight because you are our creator and our redeemer. You give us life and breath for each moment. And you love us even when we sin against you. We give our offering tonight out of gratitude to you for all you've done for us. Help us to use these gifts wisely. Bless Brother Murari as he preaches tonight. Give him strength and wisdom by the Spirit. And as we listen, help us to understand more clearly who Jesus is and who we are. Use your word to prepare us for the week ahead. Teach us how to rest in Jesus' finished work as we serve you. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
As you remain seated, let's sing as we prepare our hearts. Trinity Psalter Hymnal 525, Savior, like a shepherd lead us. Amen. Join me in your Bibles this evening in the Gospel of John, chapter 4. We're going to be spending our time this evening in a precious, precious story of the Samaritan woman. John, chapter 4. We'll start at verse 1. Now when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee. And he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria?" for Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. The woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock. Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water. Jesus said to her, go, call your husband and come here. The woman answered him, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you are right in saying, I have no husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true. The woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. Now jump to verse 28. So the woman left her water jar and went away into town and said to the people, come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ? They went out of the town and were coming to him. And now jump to verse 39. Many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with him, and he stayed there 2 days, and many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world. This is God's word. Join me in a word of prayer. Oh Lord, thank you that you have given us your written word. And you have given us the eternal word who is Christ. And you have also given us the gospel word. This evening, we pray that you would show us our need and show us our Savior. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So, I don't know if you've ever met someone who is good at diagnosing or troubleshooting things. Maybe a tech support person or a mechanic. And sometimes the experience of someone who is very knowledgeable to diagnose things is a very interesting experience where they're not there with you, but they know exactly what the problem is and can almost finish a sentence. And you're like, yeah, that's what's happening. Or a mechanic, right? If you don't know too much about car mechanics, sometimes you just make the noise and they're like, I think I know what it is. And they begin to diagnose to repair the problem. Or how about a mentor or a counselor? Someone to whom you come to share a need, a personal problem. And they know you so well that they can also finish your thoughts and then provide the necessary wisdom and advice for the problem. Well, our story tonight is a very well-known story. It's the story of the Samaritan woman. And this woman in this passage meets the light and life and the Lamb of God that John speaks of in chapters 1. She will meet the great counselor. And so John 4 will show us this evening that Jesus is a Savior who truly knows us, truly loves us, and in love transforms us. Let me say that again. Jesus is a Savior who truly knows us, truly loves us, and in love transforms us. So, let's walk through this chapter under three headings. One, Jesus comes to us, comes to where we are. Secondly, Jesus comes to show us our need. And third, Jesus comes to us as Savior. So let's start with Jesus comes to where we are. In our lives, we have experiences, and in those experiences, oftentimes there are details. And those details are germane to that experience, that event. For those of you who are old enough, if someone were to ask you, do you remember where you were when JFK was assassinated? And you could probably say, yeah, and then give the details, because it was such an impacting event. Or maybe those of us who are a little younger, if someone asked you, where were you when you heard of the 9/11 attacks? Well, personally, I remember the day and the mood of that day. And as I made my way to work and I drove past LAX airport, I noticed that no airplanes were moving. Now, LAX is a very busy airport, and I noticed that there were no airplanes. And at that point, I still hadn't heard any of the news, but it was a mood. And then noticing the airport, I thought, oh, that's weird. Until I arrived at the office, and all I hear is a commotion and everyone gathering in conference rooms to watch live footage in the news. Now, as you can see, I can tell you details, the mood of that day, my observation of the airport. It was a very impactful day. Now, it doesn't have to be negative. What about the day that, gentlemen, you proposed to your wife? Or ladies, when he proposed, and you can recall all of the details. But most importantly, do you remember where you were when the light of the gospel shone into your heart and mind? That place, that moment, the people. All of these details are important in God's sovereign plan. And that's what we find in this first section. We might think that in this first section, there's just, you know, an intro to the location. But we discover that there's a controversy that's brewing. And the passage says that Jesus had to go through Samaria. He had to. And two reasons why he had to. One is the controversy that was brewing between the Pharisees and Jesus. And also a controversy that in chapter 3 was already brewing between John's disciples, John the Baptist's disciples, and a Jew. Now, to the Pharisees, John the Baptist and Jesus were a problem. Why? John the Baptist confronted the Pharisees in their religious hypocrisy. And now to realize that this teacher, Jesus, is also drawing followers after himself was another problem. In that time, the Pharisees were a religious group, a religious sect that curried favor with the people, the everyday man. Their counterparts, the Sadducees, curried favor with the powerful, the elite. And so, the Pharisees are thinking, and they have now learned that Jesus is baptizing and drawing disciples after himself. He's encroaching on our territory. But there was also a second reason why Jesus had to go through Samaria. And that's because there was a person in need. And also, look at the details of Sychar. There's the mention of Jacob and the well that's there that was given to that region by Jacob. And that also talks about the well and the time. There's a timestamp in this encounter that Jesus will have. Now, this is full of meaning, very packed with meaning, because we've seen how in chapter one, there's already an allusion to Jacob. Jesus tells Nathanael that now you will see the heavens open and angels ascending and descending on the Son of Man. And here again, we see an allusion to Jacob again. All of these things are very important, again, to the life and the redeeming work of Jesus Christ. And so John spares no details. All of these are very important. So, where were you when the light of the gospel broke through and connected with your heart and mind? And the Lord began to make a transformation in your heart. Maybe you were in your bedroom wrestling with doubt and wrestling with Jesus and the gospel. Maybe you were in a Bible study. And in that moment, doctrine and your heart came together. And you realized at that moment, yes, Jesus loves me. Maybe you had my experience when at the age of 25, racked with doubt and lack of assurance, having grown up in a Christian family and not feeling that assurance, that confidence in the Lord, listening to the late great R.C. Sproul share the gospel through one of his teachings, and I'm stuck in traffic, racked with doubt. And in that moment, the light went on and the gospel connected with my heart. In that moment, in that location, the Lord Jesus was working in a deep and meaningful way to show us our need of him. Consider with me now, Jesus comes to show us our need. One of the privileges that I have being an elder and an intern at our church is that of having membership interviews. And I get to hear stories of God's work in the lives of so many people, so many of you. And one thing that emerges in so many stories is that moment when the gospel connected. And the clarity that each person, each story shows, communicates when the Lord showed that person their need of Christ. And so in this story, Jesus is about to reveal to this woman her deepest need. Jesus will provide the water that can satisfy the soul. He doesn't come only to answer intellectual questions. He comes to capture our hearts. But Jesus doesn't do it with cold hard facts and theology. But like he used parables, in this story he uses metaphors. Metaphors to draw this woman to see her need and then to see her Savior. Now, one thing we need to remember also is that in the Bible, the person is not compartmentalized. Oftentimes in the West, we have the physical and the spiritual. But as we will see, Jesus uses the spiritual not because it's not reality, but because it is reality. I appreciated what Paul Tripp said this morning in the Sunday school marriage video. He said, "The heart is the causal core of your personhood." In other words, what happens in your heart is displayed with your body. Or as Jesus puts it, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so the Lord Jesus will redeem this woman, heart and soul, and her body. even as he addresses her with spiritual terms. So there's Jesus in the middle of the day by a well. When verse 7 tells us, a woman from Samaria came to draw water. Now we need to know something about this woman. From the outset, we need to know that she is very knowledgeable. She's going to bring up objections before Christ, ethnic division, heritage, religious formalism, as objections to cover, as a facade to the deep need that she has. And at the same time, there should be a question, a curiosity that should be building in our minds. Why is she coming to draw water in the middle of the day when it's really hot? And the custom is to either draw water in the morning or in the afternoon when the weather is more pleasant. Well, verse 7, Jesus creates the point of contact. And Jesus says, "Give me a drink." And then objection number one by the woman. "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman from Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Now, who were the Samaritans? Samaritans were people who were part Jew and part Gentile. When the Assyrians came and sent the people into exile and just decimated the region, there were some Jews that were left behind, and these Jews intermarried with the Gentiles. And so they were of mixed, they were mixed in their ethnicity, but full-blooded Jews rejected them. If a Jew encountered a Samaritan or a Gentile, they would consider themselves unclean. And so instead of going through Samaria to get to Galilee, oftentimes a Jew, so as to not be stained, would go around a long route to get to Galilee. And this woman knows that. And she might be trying to, again, she meets Jesus and he's just a Jew, so she's maybe trying to help him avoid becoming unclean. But Jesus knows that there's nothing that can make him unclean. And racial division is nothing to thwart the purposes of Jesus to redeem this woman. And so in verse 10, Jesus says, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." And then the woman, thinking to herself, maybe race is not chasing this guy away, thinks maybe heritage and the insignificance of Jesus compared to Father Jacob. And so she says, the woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Are you greater than our father Jacob? I wonder if maybe a little smirk came on Jesus' face because she is about to get the biggest revelation of her life. But Jesus is offering something deeper than she thinks she's not capturing what Jesus is trying to tell her. Richard Phillips, commenting on this passage, says that in Jesus' day, the expression "living water" referred to fresh running water in contrast to the stagnant water found in wells. So it's a metaphor that Jesus is using, but it's more than a metaphor. He's trying to get to the heart. And so the question still stands. Are you greater, Jesus, than our father Jacob? See, Jacob was rich. He was blessed in abundance by the Lord. He gave us this well, and he drank from it, and all that was his. Are you greater than our father Jacob? But Jesus doesn't simply answer, "Yes, I am. I'm greater than Jacob." He still draws her in more. Verse 13, Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. Jesus is inching closer and closer to the heart of the matter in the life of this woman. And more we begin to see the spiritual terms that Jesus is using. Because whoever drinks of the water that Jesus offers is for eternal life. Now the woman, still not understanding, responds, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." What could be better than stagnant well water? Springs. So she's maybe thinking, well, if this guy knows of a better place to go get water that I don't have to draw from this deep well, I'll take it. But Jesus gets to the heart of the matter. And in verse 16, he says, Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband.' For you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." So why was this woman going to a well in the middle of the day when it was hot? She was hiding in plain sight. She was living with someone. She was living with shame, coming to the well in the heat of the day, hiding in plain sight, hiding from the judgmental looks of the town. Now, one Christian writer talks about the pain that this woman experienced at this point in history. The Samaritan woman lived in a culture where she needed a man. She needed a man for economic reasons, for legal reasons, for religious reasons. And she had gone through five men. Men who used her and abused her and moved on. And now the man that she's with is not even her husband. It's a temporary fix for what really, really ails her. And Jesus has exposed her. And the woman says, "Sir," verse 19, "I perceive you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." So the woman now is exposed. She has been revealed for what her need is, what her problem, what her shame is. And she still has one more objection. She says, "I perceive that you're a prophet." And she's thinking maybe that, like the prophets of old, he's calling her to repentance and to come to the proper worship of God, like Isaiah did in the Old Testament, where he called the sins of Judah and was calling the people to repentance and to proper worship of God. See, the woman knows the prophecies. She knows that Messiah is anticipated. How many times do we put excuses or objections forward when we're confronted by the gospel? We say, "Well, I'm part of the right denomination. I subscribe to the right standards. I went to a Christian school, grew up in a Christian home. I was catechized, and yet we're racked with shame and guilt. And the gospel comes and shines a light on our very need. And we refuse to see that deeper need. And we put forward superficial things. You see, what we need is not the correct doctrine down to a T. What we need is a person. Well, who we need is Christ. And so, consider with me, Jesus comes to us as a Savior. As any good biblical counselor does, a counselor is able to guide a person to the root of the problem and present Christ as the answer. I remember being able to observe a counseling session where the Christian counselor was able to get to the root of the problem that the counselee was experiencing. And as the tears were welling up in this counselee's eyes and she starts crying, and she knows what her need is, she knows what the root of the problem is, and the counselor continuously pointed the counselee to Christ. And this is what Jesus is doing as the great counselor that he is. Jesus has been leading this woman to a crescendo. He has slowly but surely been able to bring her to the point of the big reveal. She says, I know that Messiah is coming, the Christ, and he'll show us all things. And then verse 26, Jesus says to her, I who speak to you am he. Now, the English version of this passage, because of the logic of English, kind of loses its power a little bit, but a more literal translation would say, Jesus is saying, I am. The woman realizes, yes, Messiah is coming. We anticipate him. And Jesus says, I am. This is a Moses moment where Moses sees the burning bush and the Lord reveals his covenant name to him. The Lord Jesus is doing the same thing with this woman. I am he, the one who speaks to you. See, the Savior of Israel, the one who saved Israel from Egypt, out of Egypt, is the one who's speaking to this woman, to this no-name woman. We're not given her name. We're just told she's a woman from Samaria. And this covenant-keeping God, Jehovah himself, reveals himself to her. He is her Savior. And then the disciples come like a commercial at the wrong time of a good storyline. And it says, and then Jesus, his disciples came back. Now, I won't be addressing this whole encounter with the disciples because it requires its own sermon unto itself. But suffice it to say that even the fact that the disciples were not there was by the sovereign will of God. Because they themselves would have probably, like when the children were coming to Jesus, they were shooing away the children from Jesus, and Jesus has to tell them, let the children come to me. Indeed, even the questions that they asked the Lord, why were you talking to that woman? What was the whole deal behind that? They would not have understood why Jesus was talking to the Samaritan woman. And this should tell us at least one thing, that oftentimes, as Christians, we can be a stumbling block. We can get in the way of the gospel many times. But at the same time, there's a promise in this passage for the disciples that they will be those who labor and will receive a harvest for the work that they will do. But back to the woman. In that moment, her eyes have been opened. And we know this because she can't contain herself. What does she do? She runs to the town and tells everyone. And verse 28 tells us, so the woman left her water jar and went away into town and said to the people, come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ? And then the people, They went out of the town and were coming to him. Here is a man who did not take from her, who did not abuse her, but knows her deeply and loves her and redeems her. And the people hear this and who knew her, and they come out to find the Savior, to find this Christ. And verse 30 tells us, they went out of the town and were coming to him. And then verse 39, many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them. And he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world. So in a time when a woman's testimony did not hold any authority in a court, the testimony of the gospel impacted the hearts of the town, and the people came out to see and to meet Jesus and can confirm this indeed is the Savior of the world. Does your gospel transformation point others to Christ? Does your testimony showcase the love of the Savior? It should. It's true, our testimony is not the gospel and should certainly not take the place of the gospel. But a transformed life points to Christ and the work of the gospel in each individual life. In my own life, the gospel brought assurance. I don't live in doubt anymore, thinking that I have to appease God by works, by deeds, to retain my salvation. What is your well story? Is your well story worth sharing? If you're here tonight and are wrestling with Jesus and you don't know Jesus, in the gospel, he has come to meet you at the deepest well of your need. And he seeks to truly know you and to truly love you. And like the Samaritan woman, he won't reject you. Christian, this Christ is offered to you in the gospel as well. There are still wells in the Christian walk that we go to. Wells of money, family, religious formalism, career. And we go to these wells to satisfy a deep thirst. But only the Savior, full of love, can provide that water. Listen to what Revelation 22 says. This is still the invitation to us. Revelation 22:17 says, and let the one who is thirsty come. Let the one who desires take the water of life without price. That, dear brothers and sisters, is Christ whom we need. Let's pray. Oh, Lord, thank you that you are the living water, that we don't have to go to cisterns and to dry wells to try to satisfy our souls, but you are a spring, water that comes to us to satisfy our deepest needs. Lord, you are indeed the Savior. And we pray that you would press this truth, this loving truth, this gracious truth to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand as we respond with Trinity Psalter Hymnal 456, Jesus, What a Friend for Sinners. I love our call to worship this evening, which said, "Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit." Dear congregation, the Lord does not shy away from our doubts, our shame, our sin, but he helps us to see our need of him, and he invites us to himself. So let that be a reminder as we go and face this week. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you that you receive us to yourself, that you don't require fitness before we come to you, but in your love and in your grace, you provide that fitness. We pray that in our lives, Christ would be exalted, and that we would continually meet Jesus day by day, in your word, in prayer, in the fellowship of the saints, and at your table. We thank you that you've given us these means as a means of grace to remind us daily of our need and of our Savior. We thank you and we love you in Jesus' name. Amen.